Hey YouTube, we're here with the UMX F-16 made by Horizon Hobby. Really cool plane. I added some LEDs in the wings. I can show you that real quick. We've got this thing bound up. I've had these LEDs in here for a while. I had been flying it on these little 180 milliamp 2S batteries, and they run a little bit cheaper than the ones from eFlight. That'd be kind of like this here, be a 2S configuration also. This one has a 30C pack rating, and this one has a 25C pack rating. We've had pretty good luck. And I also fly with this pack, which is an eFlight pack. This one came with my Carbon Cub SS. That was back when you used to get a battery with most of these UMX planes, but also it was a lot more expensive. So 180 milliamp at 20C, so I figured this one would be similar. Either way, the point is, the plane sucks. It was probably the biggest disappointment in my playing career, aside from the Habu 180 UMX. And I know there's a lot of you that disagree with me. This plane does fly. I added the lights and everything, but that it pretty much flew crappy. Maybe I got 20 or 30 flights out of it. And what I found, the best way to do it was basically pull the gear, and you just pull them straight out. You can kind of see I have that one started pulling out. Because every time I fly it, I just pull the gear out, and then I just set it up there for display, where I store my UMX planes. It's a sweet looking plane. I had problems with mine right off the bat. I had to repair this. So beyond that, it's a really cool plane. I was also disappointed because I really badly wanted to do flaperons, and I wasn't able to do that. I know I saw one other guy on YouTube had taken and attached flaperons here to the, and they're not flaperons, they're just ailerons. I wanted flaperons. I wanted to do spoilers and flaps, and that was just not going to happen. I wanted to do a leading edge slat and all this cool stuff, and there's just not enough weight capacity, guys. Let's talk about weight for a minute, and that's part of the reason why I wanted to show you the little battery. So I'll go ahead and plug one of these in real quick, just understanding that this is the pack that I would typically use. Throttle cuts on. I was getting somewhere between 2 and 4 minutes flight time. Okay, and AS3X jitters is nothing new to the UMX line. We got rudder and then televons. And I also programmed in these settings that basically give us kind of like a launch mode. So you can see we've got the red and we've got the green. And that's all I did. I kept things very, very light. I used an extremely small wire. So let's just show you what this thing weighs real quick. I got my scale over here set up, the one I got basically from junk projects at work. I've got a test weight on there just to show you. It's a 0.2 pound test weight, so it's measuring 0.2 and bouncing back and forth. And then I'm going to switch it to you grams. Zero it, and I'll just lay this plane on here, and then you guys can see what it weighs. So it's basically, with battery, it's 78 and a quarter grams. It's a very small plane, all in. And then just for grins and giggles, I'm going to pause it. We'll throw the other battery and measure it. Okay, so now with the 200 milliamp hour 2S. Actually, you know what? I'm just going to go for the one that I would typically use, which is 300 milliamp hour 2S, 35 through 70C discharge rate. So meaning it's a 35C rating, and it will discharge for bursts at double that for a short period. So real quick, we'll just get you guys a weight of that too here, so we have no ambiguity, and I'll write it down so we've got it. Okay, starting from 0 grams, we lay that on the scale. I'll point the camera over there. Looks like about 83 or 82.65. So, okay, so what we've got here is we've got these two weight readings. This just gives us a baseline. What I'm wanting to do is I'm wanting to jump it up to a 3S pack, which would be 180 milliamp nano-tech 25 through 40C discharge that runs on a JST. Now, I've already tried running this plane on a 3S configuration, and it did not handle it. It did not like it, and so I know I can't do it on the stock ESC. I know there's a couple of guys out there that might have gotten away with it. It's like I said on these UMX planes and other videos, I've mentioned it. Sometimes you get away with it and sometimes you don't, but I think generally on the EDF planes, you're not going to get away with it, because I killed my Habu doing that. And I know there's some guys that have gotten away with it, but they must have just got lucky. So let me show you what I'm planning on doing, and we'll see if it'll work. Okay, so anybody who has this plane already knows this little trick, but basically this cover here covers up access to your controller board, but there's an export that just happens to be visible right there, which is really kind of handy. And so what I plan to do is I plan to just put another servo in there and see if we can actually tap into that export. And we'll see what type of output we get relative to the different control surfaces that we have access to. So I'm going to go ahead and get a servo out, and I'll show you what it looks like. Okay, guys, so I got a little linear long throws servo, and I'm just going to get this lined up, get my polarity right. And the only way to tell which way the thing is going to plug in there is just, you got to look closely. There's a little clip that will be, try to get some light in there so you guys can see. Okay, so there's a little rail that's closer to one side versus the other, and then if you take and look at the plug that would mate up to it, you can see that that rail on the side of there lines up more with one side than the other. So I'm just gonna plug it in there. Now don't worry if you're in the wrong side, it's not gonna matter, it won't hurt it, it's just not gonna work. Okay, so you can see how that thing move to one side. So I can pretty much tell you that there's something happening on there in terms of activity. So let's just see what it is. Okay, my throttle cut's on, so it could be attached to throttle. Okay, it's not moving with rudder, it's not moving with aileron, it's not moving with elevator, so maybe it's throttle, because you can see it's all the way pushed back. So my throttle cut's on, I'm gonna turn that off. Bear with me here. Okay, no change there, guys. It did not move the servo. So that means that this might be tied to another channel. So what I need to do is I need to go through the other channels. Throttle cut's back on, cleared my timer. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to grab, and I'm just going to look at my monitor, and it looks like nothing's... Okay, so like auxiliary 2 doesn't make any impact on that servo. So it's not auxiliary 2. Looks like the gear channel doesn't have any impact on that servo. And that's not doing anything. That's not doing anything either. So that's auxiliary 3. And I mean, you could use some intuitive different types of tests, but it looks like right now that's just the elevator. It's not moving with that either. So that means we're either in the wrong side or this port's not active. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to pull this out. You'll notice it lines up in two different ways. There's one way, and then the other way is over here. So I'm just going to plug that into the other side. Go through our regular control surfaces, see if we have any response, which we don't. Nothing, 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 nothing. Okay, so that's on the other side. So now we got to do throttle again. So my hope is what will happen is that this thing will slide up and down along with the throttle. So throttle cuts off, and I see no activity, so that's not good. So what that tells me is that export may or may not be available to be used, but what I want to do is do just a little bit more investigation. Oh, it looks like there is another port in there. So I'm just going to double check. I hate opening these things up unless I absolutely have to. So that's probably what we're going to have to do next. So I'm going to go ahead and get it cut open, and I'll come right back to you guys. Okay, so what I did was I took my knife and I just ran it down like that so that I didn't have to worry about cutting the finish anywhere else. And then I'm just going to pull this up. See? And it just comes right up, guys. Then I'm going to do the same thing over here because there is a piece of tape in there. Now, you could peel that tape, but then you're going to pull off this United States Air Force label. And I don't want to lose that label. So I'm just going to peel this, and then I'm just going to lean it back. And I'm going to peel off the tape. Okay, so keep that aside for later recovery. Alright, cool. So now what we see here is we can see that I'd really hope to obviously not open that up to that extent. You can see there's another port down here. Now, what is that port, you might ask? Well, I don't really know, to be honest. So we're gonna find out. And by the way, that AS3X jitters, if that gets too annoying for you, just unplug it. We'll come right back to it. What you're gonna do is you're gonna take this plug. It's only gonna plug one way now because this is only three pins. It's not four pins like that X port, which this would be an X port over here because it's wider. And I think typically that'd be used for like FPV cameras and things like that. Okay, so anyway, that's plugged in. Let's go ahead and reinitiate contact. We got our throttle cut on. Yeah, and I just heard that thing run, so whatever it is, it's doing something. See, it went to the center there, guys. So let's see what that's attached to. Looks like rudder doesn't do anything. Ailerons. It's an aileron port, guys. Elevator, aileron. Looks like elevator and aileron. So that's going to be pretty well useless to us because that channel is already being used for the control surfaces of the rest of the plane. So we can't really use that port. So now that we've got this open, let's go ahead and let's plug it in to this port here. And I'm just going to do this now that I've got a better visibility on it is all I'm looking at. And it's definitely live. Nothing with rudder. Nothing with ailerons. Nothing with elevator. Nothing with gear. Nothing with flaps. Nothing. Okay, so we'll do the same thing. We'll just pop it over one little port. And guys, this is just a really quick and easy way to test and see. And you can tell if it's live because it's going to move or it's not going to move. Well, in this case, that second side is not going to give us a good ground, so it's not going to operate. And so in our case, the ground has to be over on this side. So that's a little discouraging. So what that means for us is this. You would be able to take your rudder channel and use your rudder channel to run an external ESC, which would allow you the opportunity to run an external ESC, but of course you're going to be losing your rudder channel. So I don't know if you guys need the rudder channel or not. I mean, the rudder channel, in my opinion, on a plane like this is kind of handy, but is it required? Well, I wouldn't say it's required. But the thing that irritates me about that is we have an open port here again from Horizon Hobby that they've locked down that's not doing any good for anybody that we bought and paid for, which is irritating. The other thing is, if you go ahead and take this out, then that would give you a little bit of extra change in weight to manage a larger battery. So in this case, it looks like this battery is quite a bit bigger. So let's see if the thing will even fit in there. Now, don't forget, guys, this thing is not, like, underneath there, you got the inlet for your air going to the motor. And, whoops, forgot that. Yeah, it looks like that would actually fit pretty darn good. So the trouble is then, of course, we have to figure out, is it worth it? Because then we've got the added extra expense of some sort of an external power supply, or ESC rather. And this is a 10 amp. It's a little Hobby King product. It's available to run up to 3S LiPo. It's got a linear BEC. And of course, it's got the big connector. So what I'd end up doing is I would shorten the wires as much as I could possibly shorten them. And I would actually backfeed into one of these unused ports, the power there. And then I wouldn't have to run parallel power to this receiver. And then I would run my battery straight off of this. But I'm just not 100% sure I want to give up the stupid rudder channel. So I got to do a little bit of thinking on that. But here's my problem, is that this plane sucks so bad because it's so anemic. I even cut vents into the side. And the vents were really helpful, but they just were too helpful. And so I had to back them off. And this plane has just been kind of a thorn in my side. So I'm not sure the best maneuver. I suppose two different methods you could do this. You could replace the whole motor and, you know, in the fan. But I just don't think that's going to necessarily guarantee it's going to work because the ESC is still this onboard ESC. And I think really what I need is I need to get that extra voltage and go for the 3S configuration. I think that's the only way I'm going to be able to salvage this plane. Because as it sits, it's sort of useless to me because who cares if I have a rudder on a plane I don't want to fly because it's a turd and it doesn't fly. But then if I get it flying, you know, so I'm kind of at that catch-22 right now. So I'm going to do some investigating, and I will come right back to you. All right, guys, I might have some good news here. You'll notice that when I flip my flat mode switch, this thing's moving now. Well, what I had going on here was that my flap system, I didn't have anything activated for that because I actually have the wing type set to flap, one servo for flap plus two ailerons. The reason I do that is so I can get my elevator correction for my hand launch setting. And so because I wasn't actually using the flaps, I just went ahead and did that. So now we can go ahead and retest this and see if we get lucky. So here goes nothing. Go ahead and plug this back in. Throttle cuts on again. I know there's not like really any risk of getting hit with a prop on this one, but I don't want it to fly off the bench either. So as you can see, it's plugged in. It's ready to go. We've got response here. We've got response there. We've got response on the rudder. And we've got the elevator correction, but that's it. So now let's see what goes on when I hook up the export here. It's going to be pretty cool if this works. I'll be really happy, actually. Okay, so in that first position, it's live. It's just not necessarily doing anything. Okay, so I don't see anything changing there. So now let's go ahead. Whoa. No, it's just when I bump it, it tries to correct the position. So let's unplug it there and just move it over one click. Just make sure it's not going to work. It's probably not going to work, though. Yep, nothing. So let's test the throttle one more time. No change whatsoever. So basically, we're screwed. The only way to do this is to give up the rudder. And, you know, you don't think about that rudder being that big a deal until you go to take off from the ground and you don't have a nose wheel steering, but you also don't have a rudder to point the plane straight. So that leads me to the tough choice. Do I give up the rudder and try to salvage the plane and make something of it, and then it's basically a bank and yank without rudder, or do I just let it live on into infamy sucking? So that's the tough call. The other thing I could do is I could get a different controller board. Receiver, multi-purpose receiver board, or whatever you guys want to call that. For instance, one from the Haboo that would have safe on it. And I'm pretty sure I can actually hook up to that. So I'll have to do some thinking. I'll come right back to you guys. All right, guys. I figured out how to do this, possibly. And what's going to have to happen is that this UMX brick receiver is going to have to get taken out. I'm going to have to untape this. I taped over that antenna. I'm going to have to cut here. Eventually, I'll desolder these three leads. And basically, what I'll have to do is I'll have to take this electronic speed control, take the two power wires, shorten them up to an appropriate length, and tap power that's coming from the battery. In my case, that's going to end up being a JST connector so that it can receive this plug rather than the E-flight end that would accept this plug. And then I also need to feed in to the signal, which would be the white wire, onto the back side of this board. These three wires will then hook up to those three existing wires with a bit of heat shrink, or I'll just desolder it back here. I'm not sure. I'll probably just cut them short and put a little heat shrink on there because I don't want to cut off this cover and have to deal with a bunch of problems with heat sinking and all that. But either way, that's my plan right now. I don't need the positive and negative off of here because the BEC is not going to be needed to make this thing run because there's already a battery elimination circuit in here and we're going to be supplying voltage to it. So I think we'll be okay with that step. Now it's just a matter of basically opening this thing up, getting to the other side so that I can attempt to tap the signal wire. And once we've tapped the signal wire, we don't have to give up the rudder, which is really nice. I was not really excited about doing something like that. So I guess for now, I'm going to go ahead and get this thing flipped over, and we'll start there. While we're between steps, and while this tip is cool, I'm going to take this tip out and put in a fine tip. I just wanted to remind you guys about that, because you're going to need a fine tip to desolder this stuff. Fine tip looks something like this. This is cold right now. So, and I'm always leery about that because many, many moons ago, I was working on a stereo project and I decided I would pick up my cool iron. And yeah, it was not cool. You learn your lesson on these stupid mistakes very easy. Because when your hand looks like a hamburger with grill marks on it, the pain is very memorable. Anyway, I'll come back to you in a little bit when I got that thing flipped over. Alright guys, I just want to show you this. The difference in weight between these two batteries is pretty minimal. We got about a 1 gram difference. So I'll just show you that real quick. 16.25 grams. And we've got 17.8 grams for the 3S. And for grins and giggles, guys, we got 11.85 grams. That's going to be for the 2S, smaller 2S, 180 milliamp. Okay, so guys, I untaped my antenna. And I want to warn you about that. The antenna is very delicate, as you can imagine. So get that taken care of first. You don't get two or three shots at those. They pretty much, when they're broke, they're done. And yes, you can actually solder on a new lead if you decide to try that. And there's certain lengths that are appropriate for whatever bandwidth you're operating within. And I'm probably oversimplifying that a little bit, but I'm not a radar or radio frequency expert. This is another thing you want to do is just take those stupid stickers off. I hate those things. I wish they wouldn't have to do that, but I think that's more of a rating, safety ratings and things like that. But I just hate all these stupid little labels. They always get in the way every time I'm doing this. And at least like in the Cessna 182, they actually do serve a secondary purpose, and that is they show the part numbers. These don't even have that. So anyway, we'll just bring it in here for a little bit closer shot. So real quick, what we're trying to do is we're trying to flip this board over. We're going to try to get this wire pulled out so we can work with it. We don't want to cut any components on the bottom, so we're just going to lift it very gently. And we broke that right there. That's what we wanted to break. Okay? Then I'm just going to be gentle with my wires and just break the other side. Hopefully we don't lose any of the components. And yes, that could happen. So obviously, if I haven't said it before, I'm saying it now. Do this at your own peril. Okay, so this wire is wanting to detach going to the rudder. So as I typically do, I'm going to grab just any color marker. In this case, I just grabbed blue. So I'm going to mark this. I mean, and this is not rocket science stuff here, guys. You don't need to mark it. I'm just marking it for ease later because I don't like remembering crap like this. It doesn't really matter in my life. So once I unplug this, oh, that son of a gun just does not want to come out. It's almost like I glued it in or something. And that's always a possibility, too. I may have actually glued that thing in. I don't know why I would do that. I'm going to just try not disconnecting it because I don't want to deal with it. Okay, so real quick, we'll just flip this upside down so we can get a look at it. Ooh, look at that. Look at that beautiful soldering job, Horizon. Wow, beautiful, guys. So anyway, you can get back to me on that one later. So I'm just going to take this knife and I'm just going to score this just a little bit. There it goes. Finally got it. Okay. So now I've got to get this thing flipped upside down so I can get to it to solder it. I'm going to leave it in place as much as I can and still get the job done. The second thing I need to do before I actually can get to that, I'm going to grab these pliers and start working these wires out very carefully. There's going to be a plug in here. This plug is what plugs in the brushless motor downstairs that's hooked up to the EDF. And I've got this resistor. I've got two resistors here. Those resistors are used for the LEDs on this plane. So, of course, I got all my aftermarket crap in the way, as usual. Alright, so I'm just gently, slowly pulling that out so I can get to it. Oh, cool. There we go. Okay. So we don't have a whole lot of length on that. But we do have plenty of length to make this project work, I think. Because all I got to do is flip this upside down. And it looks like I have not really tons of wire here to work with on my existing elaborate wiring for the LEDs. And when I say elaborate, I say that facetiously. It's not really all that elaborate at all. I'm just trying to scooch it back. Okay, looks like it might have been just pushed in there with pressure. I don't remember gluing it. Okay, so now I am going to go ahead and try to get this unplugged, this rudder wire, just because that is going to get in the way here now. I hate yanking on those things, but I did it anyway. All right, cool. So now that that's detached and we've got our blue mark to remind us later, I'm probably just going to flop this up on itself like this. Yep, that should be good for now. And so what we're looking at, I'm going to try to get a good angle so you guys can actually see this. What we're looking for is right here. We're going to be attaching to that spot right there. And what I might do is scoot you guys over just a little bit so you can get a little closer to the light so you can see what I'm talking about. You're going to be going off of that little wire there. Now you can probably understand what I was talking about with really needing to okay. You're looking at it right there, guys. Right there. That's where you're going. Okay? So here in a minute, you're going to be able to see this, and we're going to see if that works. I'm going to test it with the servo before I go any further. All right, guys. I got this relatively huge wire right now. I tinned the tip of it. Okay, this is not a solid core wire. Remember, this is not power we're transmitting, this is signal we're transmitting. So what I want to do is I want to take this tip and I want to shorten it as short as I can make it so that I still have copper exposed. And when I say copper, I mean copper, because that's what this is. It's a copper-based wire here. So then my next step is going to be pretty simple. It's going to be to solder this one lead onto that one contact point. I'm not worried about anything else yet. I'm just trying to get power. Excuse me, I'm just trying to get signal off of this brick so that I can run my controls. And I'm going to test it with the servo. Okay. So here goes nothing, guys. Gotta clean the tip a little bit more on my soldering iron. Get some build up there. This is a brand new tip, so it shouldn't be a problem, but you know how things go. I'm gonna get you guys a little closer view too while we're at it. Okay, so I've just got the wire kind of bent in a position. I'm recoating the tip of my soldering iron. I'm holding the plane steady. Gosh, I hate using these fine tips soldering irons, but when you need them, right? It's very small, so. And these high consequence solders are always the ones that get me shaken. Okay, so I just got that soldered on there. It looks decent. I'm probably going to go ahead and back up the zoom here and give you guys a different angle of it here so you can see what's going on there. We're going to try to test this. I'm going to pause this until I get my test set up. Okay, so I'm taking this little short extension cord as part of my testing tool. I'm going to clip off the end. This is going to allow me to plug it in to one of the accessible ports. I'm going to pull power off of two of these lines. The third line is going to be the signal line. It's going to be this one that we just tapped off of the actual board. Okay? Just telling you what I'm doing. I'll show you in a minute. Okay, guys. Remember, this is only a test. So what I've done is I've stolen power here, fed a regular servo, and so I got to fiddle with the connector just a little bit to try to make contact. And essentially, you guys can see that thing working in there. That's my throttle channel, guys. I'll just go over here to prove to you. There's your throttle channel moving up and down. I disconnected my electronic speed control. So there's our signal output. And so now throttle cuts on and it stops working. Of course, the jitters and all the usual stuff. So we're getting on about the end of this video. And hope that helped. So we were correct in our positioning of where we tapped our output signal. And now all I've got to do is just wire up everything else and make it actually work this time. But just wanted to prove to you guys that you could have some confidence in that position here. We'll give you one more shot at that. I'm going to unplug the power, just be on the safe side.